Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Besom, Stang, and Sword, a guide to traditional witchcraft, the sixfold path, and the hidden landscape, by Christopher Orapello and Tara Love Maguire. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. This book contains advice and information relating to herbs, and is not meant to diagnose, treat, or prescribe. It should be used to supplement, not replace, the advice of your physician or other trained healthcare practitioner. If you know or suspect you have a medical condition, are experiencing physical symptoms, or if you feel unwell, seek your physician's advice before embarking on any medical program or treatment. Some of the substances discussed in this book can be lethal if mishandled or ingested in sufficient quantities. Extreme caution is advised in their handling and use. Listeners using the information in this book do so entirely at their own risk, and the author and publisher accept no liability if adverse effects are caused. Introduction. For those who have gone before, and those who have yet to be. In the spring of 2014, we began the journey that this book has grown to embody, the development of a modern system of regional traditional witchcraft. It sprang forth from our finally coming together as a couple to practice magic and ritual, after never having done so since we first met in the summer of 2001. This system, which morphed out of our individual paths and influences, came to be called Black Tree, a name that, at first, only reflected our fascination with the curious blackthorn tree. We later realized that this tree held a much deeper significance for what we were doing, specifically because of the black tree, which is our name and spelling for a symbol that we use in our practice. The Black Tree Path became our unique form of traditional witchcraft. It distinctly reflects our individual North American upbringings, but is also inspired by the writings of Robert Cochrane, as well as those of Sarah Ann Lawless, Peter Patton, Gemma Gary, Nigel Pinnock, Paul Hewson, Andrew Chumley, and many others. Traditional witchcraft initially caught our interest because of how it differed from the more common forms of Wicca that have been so prevalent over the past 50 years. The realization that people were looking to the past in a new way through the scholarly pursuits of Carlo Ginzburg, Jeffrey B. Russell, Emma Wilby, Claude Lecuteau, Eva Pox, and others spoke to us. This was not myopic adherence to tradition for tradition's sake. It was the building of a strong, practical foundation with historical research, personal insight, and critical thought. This knowledge invigorated our practice and confirmed what we had been feeling for many years, that many of the more commonly practiced paths of today's paganism and the various offshoots of Wicca all contained elements that we felt were irrelevant to our lives. We sought to establish a system of witchcraft more in tune with our needs, as well as the needs of other witches like us. The Black Tree tradition, and this book, grew out of that budding desire. Black Tree is a modern, non-religious form of traditional witchcraft that is rooted in each witch's specific region. Instead of deities, it deals with the spirits of the land and the ancestors. No gods, many spirits, as we like to say. It is largely concerned with readdressing what it means to practice witchcraft beyond the tropes of modern Western paganism. Rather than being based in ceremonial magic, the practices of Black Tree are more shamanistic in nature and differ in both method and intent from the fertility-minded, deity-based Wiccan streams of witchcraft. It is a modern approach to witchcraft that retains a keen awareness of the history and lore deep in its bones and blood. In this book, we hope to provide seasoned practitioners with a new way to deepen their practice, as well as to introduce fledgling witches to the essentials of witchcraft. Our perspective anchors itself with one foot firmly planted in the lessons of the past and the other stepping into the boldest future while staying focused on the natural evolution of the craft. Like the Fool card of the tarot, we are never leaping into tomorrow. This book lays before you a toolkit full of rituals, spells, exercises and techniques that are steeped in a new perspective on practicing witchcraft in the modern day. It places witchcraft in a new light, one that shines brightly on a new era of praxis for neophytes and adepts alike. Bendif, Success and Blessings, Chris and Tara. Chapter 1. Traditional Witchcraft. Traditional witchcraft is a wild beast with many parents and even more children. At its very core, it is a chimera of folk magic, shamanism, history, ancestor veneration, and respect for the land. But it can be a little difficult to pin down its actual definition. Essentially, traditional witchcraft splits into two main categories: magical traditions and cultural practices. You can find a number of modern magical traditions under its overarching umbrella. The clan of Tubal Cain, Victor and Cora Anderson's Fairy, 1734, and the Cultus Sabbati, all of which have been influenced by earlier modern witchcraft and personal gnosis. The traditions that fall under this banner also tend to eschew dogma in favor of symbolism and imagery steeped in folklore. These paths are magical in nature and heavy in historical research and individual responsibility, with an emphasis on connecting with the environment. On the other side of the definition, traditional witchcraft also encompasses widespread cultural practices like seder, hoodoo, brujería, and curanderismo, which also involve the use of rituals, energy work, folk magic, divination, and close contact with spirits. These are all integral aspects of witchcraft itself, although individual practitioners of these paths may not actually refer to themselves as witches, and we must be careful not to disrespect their individual self-identification when discussing them. Black Tree Witchcraft, the tradition behind this book, draws elements and style from both the magical and the cultural sides of traditional witchcraft and blends them into a cohesive whole. It is generally North American in nature. After all, that's where we are from, but can easily be applied to any region. In addition, it owes a particular debt to the work of Roy Bowers, better known as Robert Cochrane. It is simply impossible to discuss traditional witchcraft in any capacity without bringing Robert Cochrane's name into it. Cochrane emerged on the English scene in 1963, just when witchcraft was enjoying its modern revival in the United States and Britain. Despite his short 3-year involvement, he made a lasting impression that echoes still. Whether this impression was good or bad depends on whom you ask. Cochrane was a firebrand who loved nothing more than stirring the pot, and he gathered as many enemies as friends. In his opinion, magic was a byproduct of the search for truth, and he spoke of a witchcraft that was more mystical in nature, focused on the realization of truth rather than its illusion. In his opinion, magic grew out of the search for truth. He suggested a re-examination of all sacred cows to see if they still produced milk and sought a reinvestigation of past cultures and practices in order to determine if they held any useful truths. Traditional witchcraft, as presented in this book, takes Cochrane's notion of witchcraft a step further. Instead of basing our magical practice on the past in an attempt to achieve authenticity, why not also look to the present, or to our immediate surroundings? Why not contact the local land spirits? If witchcraft ever existed in the world, then it exists just as much in the here and now as it ever did in the past. The notion that witchcraft is solely a phenomenon of the past, or that it must be sought in far-off lands, or that it's only found by studying and embracing ancient cultures or deities, ignores the very reality of the practice itself, as well as the power and connection we already have to our immediate surroundings. The substance, lore, and magic that we can acquire from our regional landscape are far more personal and substantial than any other connection we would ever hope to establish with any antiquated worldview or culture that is foreign to us. This book contains a new approach to witchcraft. It brings you into a territory that may seem alien at first, but one that will swiftly begin to feel like home. Our approach bypasses all the romanticized New Age fertility rites, harvest festivals, and medieval role-playing that have become so persistently intertwined with modern paganism and witchcraft, and emphasizes a deeper engagement with the land itself. Rather than enjoining you to commune with far-flung and aloof deities, this witchcraft leads you to interact with your ancestors, both nameless and blood-bound. We encourage you to make contact with the spirit of your own personal place in this world and to be unafraid of getting your hands dirty doing the work you aspire to accomplish. What is witchcraft? When we examine the history and cultural diversity of witchcraft, we learn that it is not actually a religion, but instead a practice. Cochrane might argue that witchcraft is not paganism, although it retains the memory of ancient faiths. Someone living in Europe several centuries ago might have described it in terms of sorcery, cursing, consorting with devils and demons, or performing necromantic acts. In those days, as now, many perceived witchcraft as a transgressive act, furtively performed in private and hidden from view. The terms witch and witchcraft were not viewed as positive. Instead, they were pejoratives used to denounce, demonize, and condemn folk practitioners, or anyone else for that matter, who were unfortunate enough to draw the wrong attention or upset the wrong types of people. While over the last century, a distorted and privileged view of witchcraft emerged, at least in First World countries. Indeed, prior to its 20th century revival, witchcraft wasn't considered a comfortable or safe practice. It was not viewed as a community faith tradition that was open and welcoming to the public, let alone one that came complete with children's groups, bake sales, and petitions for societal recognition. It's important to understand that outside the bounds of modern neo-paganism, witchcraft is not about the goddess or a goddess. It is not about the god or a god. It is not about seasonal celebrations commemorating the cycles of life, death, and rebirth. It is not about procuring a good harvest, literally or metaphorically. It is not about reliving the past or dancing in a cloak while drinking wine or wearing flowers in your hair. It's not even necessarily about being pagan. Witchcraft is about sovereignty. Witchcraft and sovereignty. Witchcraft ties deeply into matters of personal governance and individual control. It addresses, with blood and sweat, the ills of life and society. In the hands of those who won't sit idle as life just happens to them, it's a tool for change. It's about magic, and spells, herbs and spirits, flying and divining. It's about living in the world, for better or worse. It is raw. It is dirty. It is a skill set, a discipline. It is an art. Witchcraft is dwelling in the woods where people rarely go. It can be found right in your yard, in a nearby park, or in an undefiled and wild land. It is resting in foreign caves and beneath silent trees. It even dwells in the endless bowels of the city, a living entity all its own. It is basking under the moon at night, breathing slowly beneath the silent stars. Witchcraft is all of these things, and it has always been there, waiting to be rediscovered. It is a response to the fears lurking in the darkness and a means to deal with them. It is a weapon. It is a talent. It is an instinct. Witchcraft is not simply about magic. That is why there are sorcerers. Witchcraft is not just about herbs. That is why there are herbalists. Witchcraft is not only about divination or contacting spirits. That is why there are psychics and mediums. Witchcraft is something wholly, entirely different. It is a lifestyle, a vocation, a liminal space defined by experience. It is a virtual crossroads where several paths meet and create their own space by virtue of their intersection. Witchcraft is a methodology. It is a multifaceted practice that combines several skills and avenues of knowledge. The paths that comprise it sit squarely upon the landscape of history and folklore, individually distinguishable as magic, divination, and herbalism. Magic leads to spells and exerting your will upon the cosmos to influence desired changes and effects. Divination is the act and process of divine seeing and foretelling the future. Herbalism is the knowledge and application of herbs for medicinal, culinary, and ritual use. The combination and interplay of these three streams of knowledge enable other practices like seership, soul flight, and necromancy to take shape. It is only when these various practices are blended together that witchcraft emerges as a distinct practice that uniquely combines history and folklore, magic, divination, herbalism, hedge witchery, and necromancy into a unifying system that we refer to collectively as the sixfold path. Magic, divining, working with and growing herbs, having visions, flying out of the body, and consorting with ghosts of the dead. Witchcraft is all of these things. It consists of no religion or dogma. It has no need for clergy. It worships no deities. It celebrates no intrinsically holy days. Witchcraft is a practice that is focused on successful function rather than being beholden to the aesthetics, symbols, and affectations of 19th century occultism. Witchcraft is secular and filthy, dirty, figuratively and literally. There will be times when you walk through your everyday life bearing the stains of some working you've performed. The evidence may be anything: the faint scent of scrying incense in your hair, a smudge of charcoal on your cheek, dirt under your fingernails. You will look at these traces of your craft, and only you will know what they represent, and that knowledge will give you strength, a secret shield. You will look at them and think to yourself, "I did that," and your face will flush briefly from the power of that knowledge, your power. The Devil and the Craft. We certainly cannot deny that the devil, or a devil, has been a key figure in many European accounts of witchcraft. He has been described as the witch-maker, the grand initiator. Indeed, He was the primary reason that witchcraft became synonymous with heresy from the Middle Ages through the early modern period. It is from this association that older forms of witchcraft came to be labeled as diabolism, as they were widely understood to involve working with or worshipping the devil. It's no secret that the classic iconography of the devil, horns, forked tongue, goat legs, and pitchfork, originates in several pagan deities or nature spirits. Images and lore involving Pan, Puck, Hades, Cernunnos, Hern, and others were forerunners of the iconic image of the Christian devil, who was generally depicted as a black-winged, bat-like monster prior to the 19th century. This portrayal contrasted strongly with the typical imagery of white-winged angels like that of Lucifer prior to his fall. Other stories about the devil are rooted in fairy lore, where he appears as a man in black, riding to the hunt with his hounds and the Queen of Elfame. His mutable appearance and developing role grew and changed alongside the imagery and lore of witchcraft, an evolution that continues to this day and into the foreseeable future. To a Christian, the devil embodies sin and everything that good Christians should avoid. This implies, however, that if you are not a Christian, there is no reason at all to avoid the devil or what he represents. However, many modern witches are distinctly and quite vocally not Christian, but still find themselves arguing defensively that this Christian devil has nothing to do with their horned god. No doubt this is an argument based in self-preservation. The fact is, however, that while on the surface this may be true for many modern witches, the history of the devil and the horned god, the witch lord or witch father as some call him, are virtually one and the same. Moreover, their sameness is not actually a bad thing, nor is it something we should shy away from acknowledging or even celebrating. Indeed, it can be tricky for traditional witches to turn their backs on the devil. In doing so, we run the risk of distorting the history of witchcraft as it developed in the Western world and missing what it can still reveal to us for use in our modern practice. By rejecting what the devil encompasses or represents, we condemn what it means to be completely human, a creature of the earth, including the wildness and carnality of nature. This further instills in us the dangerously romantic view of nature as a benevolent force that looks out for our best interests. In reality, nature is not our caretaker nor our friend. We must never forget this. Nature is red in tooth and claw. The living modifications we have needed to develop just for basic survival reveal this to be undeniably true. Nature cares for us about as much as we do for a random hair found growing in a weird location. We cut it off or pluck it out without a thought. Just a momentary wince, and it's gone. Nature is a monster, as well as a thing of beauty and wonder. It has teeth and bites the hardest those who attempt to make it pink and pretty gossamer. This is not to say, however, that we should not protect and value nature. Far from it. Nature requires our stewardship, the forging of a deep connection between animal and human. As humans, we now live outside of the wild, in a world of shoes and cars and condominiums. But still, we dream. We now understand that the complexity of life is painted in shades of gray rather than black and white. We can see that it is time to tear down the tired, dueling archetypes of pure good and evil. As a representation of the wildness of nature, the devil reflects our own place in this complexity, human united with animal. Or go further and strip the devil of the many layers of myth and legend he has accrued over the centuries. Approach him as he truly is, nature itself, in its most absolute form. We embrace the devil as a symbol of humanity, as a creature of the earth, not as a trifling villain who encourages self-deception and self-loathing, or a childish pawn employed by a narcissistic creator. There is no longer a need for that in this world. We have gone beyond such vanities. We have evolved and developed our own moral codes, an innate sense of the essential dichotomy of right and wrong. In our craft, we call upon the devil as the witch lord, the lord of paths, and the uniter of worlds. He is the embodiment of nature itself. He unites the worlds within and without, above and below. He is like Eliphas Levi's iconic 19th century image of Baphomet, a blended representation of the manifested world, not good, not evil, but a duality, an integral part of the ebb and flow of existence. As we make our way into these other realms, the witch lord is our guide, our contact, our touchstone. We do not worship him, however. He is not a deity. Instead, he is the primary spirit of place and a primordial force, the devil for a new millennia of practice. Animism. Animism is a term coined by Sir Edward Tyler, known as the father of anthropology, during the late 19th century. In some ways, the term may be interpreted as meaning doctrine of soul, as it derives from anima, the Greek word for soul, and the Latin word for life or spirit. The word animated also derives from this root. If something is animated, the implication is that it's alive, that it has a soul or some kind of consciousness. Witchcraft thus exists quite well within an animistic worldview. Indeed, it almost demands it through its use of herbs and its interaction with spirits, especially the spirits of the dead. It makes sense that witchcraft is an animistic path, one that perceives everything as having a soul, including rocks, plants, trees, animals, the land, a field of flowers, the vast and wild forest, a waterfall, or the sea. On some level, all things are conscious and capable of interaction in an animistic world. By extension, all things in an animistic world must be treated as living things because they are. This may sound a bit dogmatic, but it isn't. An animistic worldview is simply a different way to relate to the land and the cosmos, a fuller perception of the world that allows us to exist within it without making too much of a mess of things. Animism views all things as distinct beings, each with its own consciousness and soul. One is one, but within the all. An animistic view does not collapse all things of the world into an overarching one. It implies no underlying monotheism or divine source. All things are connected, but still remain distinct. Thus, individual beings or objects or places may possess unique and differing purposes and temperaments. This explains why some places may feel less welcoming than others, something you may have experienced in an old building or while walking in the woods. Beings gather where places are untouched or long abandoned, and personalities of places may change over time due to interaction with other beings or just through the natural progression of life. To animists, the world is most certainly alive, and it sings in a million voices, a singular chorus of life. To witches, the world is a complex interaction of animate beings with distinct means and ends. part of becoming a witch is learning to cultivate those relationships to aid us in our craft. Becoming a witch. There has been much debate over the years as to what specifically makes someone a witch. Some believe a person is born a witch. Others believe that only initiation can make a true witch. If you do not already consider yourself a witch but would like to become one, you have already taken your first step by simply reading this book. All witches, whoever were, became so through their own doing, by deciding to practice witchcraft. To become a witch and walk a path so removed from conventional society requires that you actively seek the path. It is an act of free will, a demand for liberation and personal sovereignty. You have to desire this thing called witchcraft against the pressures of society and against what so many of us have been brought up to believe. In doing so, you sacrifice conventionality for the mysteries and experiences that the craft contains. So you don't have to be born a witch to be a witch. Moreover, no one can actually make you a witch, despite any lineage or background they may possess. It is not up to someone else whether or not you become a witch. The decision is yours alone, like playing an instrument or reading a book. It is an active choice you make, and it is a path you walk with intent. Although teachers and mentors may guide you on your way, the surest way to become a witch is by having an intention to become one and having the will to dare. The following short ritual is designed to introduce you to the witch lord and the spirits of the land. Through it, your eyes will open to a different world. You will be changed forever. It will place you fully upon the witch's path as long as you choose to walk it. This ritual actually consists of four parts: stepping into the path, creating a crossroads, hailing the witch lord, and creating the cord of sovereignty. The rite can withstand many variations, depending upon your location and living situation. Spontaneity is always a great catalyst for ritual, but the version shared here should be applicable no matter where you are or what you have at your disposal. Witchcraft does not require fancy tools and elaborate props to be successful. Farmers' markets are a great resource for locally sourced produce and other products, and are highly recommended for ferreting out what you need. Materials originating in your area help fuel your magic and infuse it with local energy, while also cultivating a connection with and personal alignment to the land. Supporting local farms and businesses helps inject life into your local economy and will assist you in your personal stewardship of the region. You will need these items to perform the rite: an offering bowl, if you are working indoors, a navigational compass, a bag of small shiny objects like glass beads, a bottle of locally produced red wine or a reasonable substitute, a small loaf of locally baked bread, a pair of scissors, a red cord roughly 1/4 inch in diameter and cut 24 inches longer than you are tall. Example: if you are 5 feet tall, you'll need a cord 7 feet long. Cut the cord to the proper length before you begin, so it's ready prior to the ritual. Stepping onto the crooked path. Perform this rite on a full moon. The clearer the sky, the better. If possible, find a secluded outdoor location. If this is not possible, you can perform the rite indoors. If outside, wear dark clothes to take advantage of the cover of night. On your way to the space, see if you can find a suitable stick or branch about waist height and bring it with you. Do not remove the branch without asking permission of the spirit of the wood. Explain your need and wait for an answer. If you feel it is permissible, leave some of the shiny objects you brought with you, but don't lose your car keys. Verbally thank the branch and the space, and continue on your way with the branch. If you are unable to procure a branch or stick or know in advance you will not be able to find one, bring a staff or cane with you. The stick/branch is not required to perform the rite, and there's always a way to substitute any ritual component. Necessity demands creativity. Once at the site, make peace with your surroundings and ask permission of the land and its accompanying spirits to proceed. If you are not welcome in that space, you will certainly know it right away. You'll feel a disquieting dread in your heart and bones that will deepen the longer you stay. If everything appears fine and favorable, determine which direction is east using your compass. Facing east, sit in silence upon the earth for several minutes, feeling the solitude and embracing the local sounds of the night. If you are lucky enough to do this outside, ask yourself these questions. What time of the year is it? What do you hear? Are you surrounded by the manic chorus of deep summer crickets and cicadas, or is this the thick of autumn with tiny peeper frogs looking for love? Are you chilly? Is the ground hard or damp? If you are inside, you can still listen. Listen and feel. Search out any other living beings in your vicinity. Can you feel the spirit of the dwelling you are in? Sit on the floor and, if weather permits, open a window to foster a stronger connection to the outside world. Now, begin to center your mind and body through slow, relaxed breathing and quiet your thoughts. This will help to bring you into the present moment and create a buffer between your everyday life and the ritual you are about to perform. Breathe deeply and slowly from your belly to induce a relaxed state. With every exhalation, gradually guide yourself into a calm breathing pattern. While still seated, consider the following to help you come to a singular moment for the rite. Think about your immediate surroundings, the walls around you, or the trees and bushes. What is before you, next to you, behind you? Think about what exists around you in the distance, east, north, west, and south. Think about where you are in relation to those places and how long it would take you to walk to them. Think about where you are in your country with those directions in mind and the distant places surrounding you, located hours away. Think about where you are on the planet in relation to other countries. Think about the ground or floor upon which you are sitting and the earthen layers of the planet existing beneath you. Think about how the entire planet is currently rotating and moving through the vastness of space, even though you can't feel it. Sit for several more minutes, experiencing this sensation of being a point in space. Once you have reached this point, stand up. If you have a branch or stick, bring it with you as you take a step and a half forward toward the east. Pause for several breaths before beginning the second part of the ritual, the crossroads rite. The crossroads rite. This is a short ritual to create a crossroads wherever you happen to be. Depending on why you are performing the rite, it can be modified to fit your intent and to fulfill a variety of functions. Here, the rite is being used to create an intersection to fulfill the role of an actual crossroads, a liminal space. It is also emblematic of the phrase, the crooked path, which is another label for witchcraft itself. The rite delineates a working area by heading in different directions and forming a solar cross. In other paths, this same symbol is also referred to as the Mark of Cain. Standing slightly east and forward from where you were just seated, face the east. If you have a branch or staff, hold it in your left hand with one end touching the ground. Say the following aloud, addressing the space as you do so. From the east, I go to west. Turn and take 3 steps to the west, dragging the branch so that it inscribes the ground, marking a trail. If you do not have a branch or staff, drag your left foot as you move to create the same effect. Now, standing 3 steps to the west, turn right and say, about to the north. Continuing to drag your branch or foot, walk 1/4 of a circle around to the north, then turn right. Face south and say, and then to the south. As you take 3 steps, crossing the center of the space where you were originally seated in meditation, say, crossing roads as I go about. Facing south, turn right and, continuing to drag your branch or foot, walk 1/4 of the way around the circle to the west and say, laying the ground for a witch's work. In the west, turn right and walk 3 steps to the east. Say, down at the crossroads is where I vow. In the east, turn right and, continuing to drag your branch or foot, walk 1/4 of the way around the circle to the south. Say, to meet with she and he and they and thou. In the south, turn right and walk 3 steps to the north. Say, upon this night and in this hour. In the north, turn right, and continuing to drag your branch or foot, walk 1/4 of the way around the circle to the east, completing the right. Say, I call upon thee to beseech thy power. Hailing the Witch Lord. Once the crossroads is established, walk from the east to the center of the space, knock or stomp 3 times upon the ground or floor. Then pause and call upon the Witch Lord using the following words, or something spontaneous of your own devising. Hail the dread Lord of Witchcraft, the wilderness and night. I, state your full name, call upon you to visit and recognize me as a wanderer and new disciple of the crooked path. I stand before you of my own free will, in silence and in secret, to know the wonders of your ways. Lord of the wild abandon, uniter of worlds, grant me your passion, permit me your blessing, as I embark upon this journey on this full moon night. From this time forth, be my guide to the greater realms throughout, about, above, and below. As I desire, it is so. Take out the bottle of wine you brought with you. Open it, and say, with this wine, the blood of the land, may it fill me with your passion, and thus it is so. Take a drink of the wine, then pour some on your left index finger and anoint your forehead. Pour out the rest of the bottle onto the ground around you while turning clockwise. If you are performing this rite indoors, pour the wine out 4 times into the offering bowl instead. Then, take out the bread you brought with you. Hold it before you and say, with this bread, made of the land, may it fill me with your blessing, and thus it is so. Eat a single piece of bread, then scatter pieces of it to the east, south, west, and north. If you are performing this rite indoors, break off 4 pieces of bread, hold up each in turn to its appropriate direction, then place them into the offering bowl. Once the offering is complete, proceed to the final portion of the rite, creating the witch's cord. The Cord of Sovereignty. The Cord of Sovereignty is the witch's cord of initiation. It is made by tying knots along the cord from foot to head. Once the last knot has been tied, the cord is cut. This ritual item is comparable to the cable toe found in Freemasonry, which symbolically delineates initiates' ability to give of themselves to their fraternity. The witch's cord also resembles the measure often found in British traditional Wicca. While the cable toe is purely symbolic, however, and is only meant to show initiates that they are in control of decisions about what comes first in their lives, the Wiccan measure is a physical object, generally a rope used to measure candidates during their actual initiation, kept by the high priest or priestess of the coven that creates a spiritual link between initiates and their coven mates. In the Black Tree tradition, we prefer to return the cord to candidates directly after initiation, so they may freely conduct themselves in the world as witches who are in control of their own lives, with no spiritual sword of Damocles hanging over their heads. To begin, tie a knot in one end of the cord. Hold this knot under your left foot between your big toe and your index toe. Thread the cord between those two toes so that your foot is holding the knot to the floor. Once this is done, say, "With this first knot, may I always be grounded, walk a balanced life, and stand strong against any threat or tyranny." Draw the rest of the cord up and tie another knot level with your groin. Say, "With this second knot, may I maintain dominion over my own being. I am my own person, now and evermore so." From the groin, draw the cord up and tie a knot level with your belly. Say, "With this third knot, may I always be full of food and drink, as well as with knowledge, wisdom, and life." From the belly, draw the cord up and tie a knot level with your heart. Say, "With this fourth knot, may I live joyously but responsibly with my emotions, and may I be passionate, reverential, and compassionate to those who need and deserve it." From the heart, draw the cord up and tie a knot level with your throat. Say, "With this fifth knot, may I forever hold sway over my own speech, and may I honor my oaths and any words that I speak henceforth." From the throat, draw the cord up and tie a knot level with your third eye, a spot on your forehead between your brows. Say, "With this sixth knot, may I see and know beyond the veil and in life, and with this sight may all be revealed unto me." From your third eye, draw the cord up and tie a knot level with the crown of your head. Say, "With this seventh knot, may the witch lord and witch queen aid and empower me in all that I do." Using the scissors, cut the cord an inch or so past the final knot and, while holding the cord, say, "With this cord of sovereignty, may I seize governance over my own self through wherever this path will take me. May I be empowered to pursue my dreams and to succeed in attaining them in accordance with my will. So mote it be." You can wear the cord as you see fit. Tie it around your waist, drape it around your neck and over your shoulders, or wrap it around your left arm, whatever is most comfortable and practical for you. Once the cord is in place, sit down, close your eyes, and relax. Take a few minutes to allow this moment to sink in. During this time, you may receive information through mental images. Instead of trying to clear your mind, explore the random thoughts that present themselves. You may be visited by the witch lord himself. You may be given a new name. You may make contact with a familiar spirit or with something more. These conversations and experiences, whether they occur mentally or verbally, are significant, so be sure to keep an open mind and be observant. When the time feels appropriate, get up from your meditation and thank the Witch Lord. Knock or stomp 3 times upon the ground or floor, and then depart. Be sure to take the empty wine bottle with you. Leave some glass beads as additional thanks and either leave the branch you found thanking it for its service or, if you feel an affinity for it, bring it home to turn into a wand or staff depending on its size and shape. If it has any leaves, be sure to save them, as they will help you identify what type of wood the branch is. Different varieties of wood hold different meanings or associations, and all things have their own voice, so be sure to begin paying attention to these sorts of messages or directions, if you don't do so already. If you performed this ritual at home, clean up the space and go outside for some fresh air. Re-engaging with the rest of the world outside your ritual space can be a little disconcerting, so it is always a good idea to re-ground yourself. Watch a film to help return your consciousness to your normal baseline. Hydrate and eat some food. If you keep a journal, write down your thoughts and experiences for later reflection. For the next month, you may want to sleep with your cord under your pillow to further enhance your relationship with it. Witches' cords are powerful tools as they embody the witches themselves and their will. After sleeping close to your cord for a month, keep it in a secret location and wear it whenever you do a working. On your path. This 4-part ritual is about introducing you to the powers and spirits of the world at large, rather than purely about initiation or dedication. It is really quite a simple ritual, despite how lengthy it appears in print. It is meant to establish communication and to begin a relationship with the spirits of your region. The Witch Lord is only one component of your local landscape. He should be viewed as a mentor and guide rather than as a deity or being to worship. He may visit your dreams or be seen in the leaves of trees on a breezy, silent night. But he is most surely your first step into the world of the craft. Chapter 2. Besom, Stang, and Sword. As you stepped onto the crooked path, you experienced firsthand what it's like to step sideways into a different world, into an unfamiliar landscape based in ritual, mystery, and magic. In this rite, you performed offerings, evocations, and proclamations. You ventured into a trance state and created a magical space, possibly without even realizing it. The tools you used were simple, and the rite was mostly dependent upon your actions, your will, and the words you spoke. In many ways, it was a small test to see if you dared to step into the shadowed unknown. After all, in order to practice witchcraft successfully, you must be prepared to step outside your comfort zone. In the magical system presented here, we use a blend of tools influenced by the practices of Robert Cochrane, traditional grimoires, and early modern understandings of witchcraft. These are by no means the only tools you may use during your practice as a witch, but they're necessary components for the system of witchcraft described in this book. Folk magic, and by default witchcraft, is mostly comprised of simple methods and techniques that allow it to succeed under any circumstance or at any location. Unfortunately, witchcraft has been turned into something of a stage production over the last 100 years. While this type of witchcraft has maintained some of the beauty and significance found in some forms of ritual, the prevalence of this habitual production has encouraged the illusion, whether intentionally or not, that there are precious few other ways to practice magic. The tools of ritual. Tools have a combined function in the performance of magic and ritual. In some ceremonial-based systems, like Wicca or the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, ritual tools become a symbolic manifestation of the elements. They function as an extension of the practitioner and, like mundane tools, also serve to accomplish specific tasks. It's far easier to pound nails into a board using a hammer than with your fist, also far less painful. In the same way, there's a practical side to ritual tools as well as a symbolic one, and both help to unite conscious with subconscious. This chapter discusses the besom, stang, and sword, as well as some more unusual tools and altars as they are viewed and used in the Black Tree tradition. Additional tools that may be required in your rituals include salt water, offering bowls, offering plates, incense, charcoal, incense tongs, candles, and a cauldron. These are all common in modern practice and shouldn't be difficult to procure. If you need any of these to perform any of the rituals presented here, they will be listed and briefly explained. You may notice that while there are formal methods for obtaining some of these items, there are no cleansing and consecration rituals recommended or provided. We feel that witchcraft is more literal in its execution than figurative. Thus, your tools become sacred or special through their use, not because of any ritual performed to make them so. At the same time, it's also commonly recognized that tools set aside specifically for ritual should be used only for that purpose and should be treated with respect outside of ritual. After all, as a craftsperson, it's important to respect your tools. We suggest that if a tool feels as if it needs to be cleansed and consecrated for some reason, you can run it through a purifying incense made of equal parts rosemary and thyme and seal it with a kiss. There is really no need for any pageantry beyond that. The besom, a union of earth and air. The word besom comes from an old word for broom. The besom is essentially a wand or staff with a cylindrical bundle of twigs or broom corn bound to one end. Because its shaft and bushel arrangement is symbolic of the union of male and female, it was used as a symbol in fertility rites and weddings. Newlywed couples jumped over it, symbolically consummating their union and ensuring many squalling babies to come. From a practical perspective, the besom also serves the common purpose of cleaning your workspace and home. It also has an interesting relationship to the path of history and lore, as it can be turned into, or at the very least resemble, a torch, which also makes it symbolic of illumination and knowledge. The inverted besom resembles a thriving tree, in contrast to the clattering bone appearance of the witch's stang. You can make your own besom with traditional materials, an ash handle, some birch twigs, and willow strips used to bind the twigs to the handle. It's more difficult than it sounds. Or you can purchase a besom from a private craftsperson. The practical role that the besom, or any tool for that matter, plays in witchcraft always supersedes the symbology of the materials from which it is crafted. In a pinch, even a fallen branch still adorned with fresh leaves can easily work as a substitute in any ritual that requires a besom. In ritual, The besom resides in the north and is used for closing and ending the ritual by sweeping the space in a counterclockwise direction. Exercise: making your own besom. For this exercise, you will need a branch, a power drill with a 1/4-inch diameter drill bit, broom corn, 4 12-inch zip ties, jute twine, 1 inch by 14 gauge nail, wire cutters, stainless steel kitchen shears or utility knife. Select the handle of your besom from a local forest. Be sure to ask the tree or the land before cutting or removing it, and then leave a suitable offering of thanks. The thickness and length of the handle are entirely up to you. Just realize that about 7 inches of the handle will be hidden by the brush end and that it should be at least 1 inch in diameter. Drill a 1/4-inch hole through the handle about 1 inch from one end. Then drill another about 1 inch from the opposite end. One hole will be used to anchor the brush, and the other will be used to create a means to hang your besom when it's not in use. Determine which end of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.